Yeah, I think all works. Then, yeah. Hello, my name is André Kless, and I welcome you to this talk. And in this talk, I would like to draw your attention to the modular web and to the possibilities that it offers to free software developers to shape the world. So, to be clear that we speak the same, what do I mean with a modular web? To make sure that my message really arrives with something, we start with something we all know, with HTML. Okay, in HTML, there is a fixed, predefined, and largely standardized number of HTML elements we all know about. Here you see one of the most popular HTML references, which list all predefined HTML elements. The upcoming web standards of web components now allow us to add our own custom HTML elements and provide them with their own semantics. To clarify the scope of the resulting possibilities, in extreme case, even a complex web application can be defined as a semantics of such an HTML element. To illustrate this, I have here an example in which a complete learning unit is packaged as an HTML element. So, my mouse. Where's my mouse? Not there. Okay, I'll try the touchpad. Okay. Here's a simple HTML example. You see, I simply have a script tag which loads in JavaScript, and the JavaScript has a code in there which defines a custom HTML element and defines its semantics. And after the script is run, the created custom HTML tag is ready to use. Yeah, here is it in use. And now we can have a look. Here you see a complete learning unit in one HTML element. Yeah, here you see also deeper functionality than that, for example, a quiz or fill in the gap text. And this for sure is only one one single HTML element. The whole application is in one HTML element. So okay. I'm not good in English, I try. Okay. However, the packaging of web applications in HTML elements alone is cool, but not yet what makes the modular web. The modular web is all about modularity. Imagine you want to program a learning unit that consists of a video followed by a quiz, with the video also being able to be commented and rated. In the content of the modular web, we do not reinvent the wheel, but first look at the web to see if someone has already developed a web component that provides the functionality what we need. Instead of building a complex web application that is difficult to maintain, we build it from already existing small, manageable, loosely coupled units. In this way, complexity cannot arise at all. When someone writes a web component with higher complexity, he's probably wrong and should think about splitting the component into several independent components. Yeah. If the root component essentially only contains the code by which other components composed into loose coupled units. The way in which web applications are built is similar in the modular web to the building of Lego building bricks. Here I have two mobile web apps that were implemented on the basis of web components. Each of these apps offers a complete German semester course. Yeah. The app comes with components for news, chat, forum, menus, videos, quizzes, and ratings. The app itself is also a component that reuses the components that components mentioned. So we can have a live look at the mobile web app. Here we have it. So this is completely built with web components. Yeah. The whole app is a web component, and it reuses components here for news. Like I say, here we have a chat. We have a forum and other things like waiting and videos and also quizzes. So we have a complex web app only built up with web components. So next, the Lego-like build of web applications from web components is a great thing, but the full strength of the modular web only shows up when the component reaches a high quality. The challenge when creating a web component is that it can be customized by simply configuring it so that it can be used in different domains without having to adapt the source code of the component. All dependent resources of the component must always be interchangeable. Yeah. Also, only a few hundred lines of code. If you have more, you have probably already done something wrong. Any good developer can solve problems in high quality through complex code. But a very good developer achieves this also with few and easily understandable lines of code. The most important ability for this is an ability to abstraction. Code is comprehensible for other developers in a few hours. Since a component does not have much code, the extra effort for a good documentation of the code is manageable. Oops. Yeah, another one, only one developer. This has an advantage which cannot be underestimated, that the developer can identify with his loosely coupled code. Usually, he then attaches more importance on its quality. As an example of a high adaptability of a web component, a brief example follows. The example shows a short video in which a quiz is created. And the quiz component is declaratively configured in HTML. So I try to start the video, and here we have it. Yeah. So here we have the script tag, and then comes the custom HTML tag. And now we configure it with the HTML attributes and inner custom elements. So, here I'm back, okay. Here again, the result of the video. The web component for quiz is loaded with a script element. The corresponding HTML element is then ready for use. An individual quiz is then created declaratively via additional inner HTML element and attributes. As with normal HTML elements, the developer of a web component can freely define which attributes and inner elements are followed for the custom HTML element and which semantics they have. So now we already know a lot about the modular web, but why should this be so relevant for the free software development community? Why can we shape the world in a new way with it? Well, just think about it. Let's take the quiz component as an example. You already know that a web component in my technology is simply a small JavaScript file. As you can see in the example, this file is free to find on the web. If you do not want to trust that the web component is always available at the web address, you can download it and upload the component to a server of your trust. The component has also been released under a free software license, as is the case for all components I produce. This means that everyone in the world can use the quiz component. The web was therefore extended by the quiz functionality. So here's the main point. It follows immediately that any web component that has been released under a free software license extends the functionality of the web as a whole. That's the main point of this talk. In order to make you aware of the consequences, we think about it for a moment longer. Assuming the free software developer community is now starting to write and publish its own components. Each component expands the amount of web applications that can be achieved by composing components. These web applications are therefore part of the functionality that the web provides on its own, without the need for a company behind it. Assuming that a company with a strong capital structure wants to prevent a company from being published because it sweetens the existence of its own commercial application. This is difficult because no one can know who has the web component JavaScript file and published it somewhere else. Even if you know all the servers and deleted the components there, still someone walk around with a USB stick containing the component. The point is that the modular web can lead to an unprecedented democratization of the web, which no company, however powerful, can undermine. From my point of view, the modular web is a great step forward coming to the digital society. From the modular web, of course, there are also much more consequences that could be clarified and be cast for a long time, so that we can also talk about other interesting things. Let's let it be good. So before we get further, first a few more words to my own person. I studied a bachelor's and master's degree in computer science at this University of Applied Sciences, and I'm specialized in complex software systems. I'm husband and father of two children and a research associate in a research project. Okay, I would like to make a point here quite clear. I'm not guided by any company interests. I'm a free man that wants to increase the functionality of the web as a whole and fights for a free democratic web in which not a single company controls everything because it has built a golden feel-good cage for all of us. So before we know, when the time allows it, have a closer look on my technology CCM, there's another important question to be clarified. How do we find out which three web components are already available? In order to make this possible, I work with my colleagues on the Web Component Cloud, shortly WWC. This is a web portal through which web components can be published, found, tried, commented, and rated. Above all, apps can be created from the components. A component plus a configuration results in an app. This means that a configuration can be created here for a component via an input mask. As a result, you get an HTML embed code for the app you created. Okay, please note that the web portal is still under construction, but feel free to explore what's already working. So we can look what's already there. Yeah, here's our web component cloud. So the first time we have a place where we can find all three software web components. At this time, we have about 27 components, I guess. Yeah, but we have here the information, contact address. And here, for example, is a quiz component we have before. If I click on details, then I get a few informations about it. Later, we can here create an app out of the component, create our own app, make the config on our own. And yeah, here are the important URLs of the JavaScript files. This is all you need to use them in any HTML file you want. And you have also a few preview images. And of course, that's already working, a live demo from the most components. Yeah, later, we have here a special button there. When you click on that, you can also create an app, but you have as initial state the configuration of exactly this demo. And you can change a little bit, save it, and you have another app. Yeah. So we're just starting to work on it, but we also have many components almost here. Okay, get back. And yeah, here I have a short video which shows the creation of an app. Concretely, this is a configuration for the fill-in-the-blank text component. The resulting embedding code is then embedded in the learning platform of this university. Their co-workers were amazed that their learning platform could suddenly take on new things without the need for any extra effort. So let's look inside. So this is an input mask from the fill-in-the-blank component. And there you get an embed code, take it. Here it's a layer platform of this university. Put it in, and yeah, voila. Okay. I'm not a good speaker, but the message is good. Okay, let's get back. Hey, that's good. Okay, here you see again the resulting embed code, which consists of a script element and a custom HTML element. So the created configuration can be stored in a data set, in a database, and can be used via the HTML element's key attribute. Here you see the key attribute. This is with one key attribute value, you have the complete configuration. So this HTML tag is one embed code, like a YouTube video embed code. It is a complete app. But instead of YouTube, here we have not video, so we have every web application we want. Okay, another question is, what can actually be implemented in the form of a web component? Are there any restrictions? The answer is no. There are no restrictions in application domain. Everything that can be implemented with modern web technologies can also be implemented as a web component. It may be composed of other components and use other frameworks. Every component is embeddable on demand and cross-domain in every web-based content. Oh, I can explain it closer. So on-demand means, most of you know it, that a component is not only embeddable when a website is loaded, it can also be included later. Cross-domain means that components must not be located on the same server where the actual website comes from, but it can be located on any other web server. With both aspects, any web user is able to embed a component in any currently viewed web page. The embedding of a component works without iframe and uses Shadow DOM for CSS encapsulating. Okay. When using my component technology, it is also very easy to implement cross-domain real-time communication. The following video demonstrates how the same component is embedded in two different learning platforms. And in this way, it is possible to suddenly collaborate between both learning platforms in real time. Oh, moment, I started again. So another platform, and I write something in there. In the other platform, we have it too. So we have a cross-platform real-time collaboration. Think of it. You can have a chat component, and you are on tagesschau.de, and you are on google.de, and someone has it from a mobile website, and all can collaborate with each other from very different places. So go back. Okay, I think questions later. What's the background of the video was? The component uses a CCM data store. My technology also offers also data management functionality. So you have a CCM data store that can be managed data in a database you want, any database you want, if you have an interface for the server. And then the server is informs all other components, all other clients with a WebSocket protocol, and then it goes there. So WebSocket protocol is the answer. Okay. Okay, because we could not see this so quickly in the small presentation, we'll try it again soon live. Does anyone know what a bookmarklet is? No? Okay. For the others, a bookmarklet is a bookmark that does not open a web page. Instead, a small piece of JavaScript code is executed. This way, you can very well embed a component in a currently open web page. If you want to try it, you can. To do this, you simply need to drag and drop one of the links from the given web page in the bookmark bar. Here we can have a look. Here are some links. And I can take, let's say this quiz here. I take it there, and now I can go, if I click on it, my quiz comes here, but I can also go on any other page. Don't know, I take Wikipedia. And yeah, also here I have my quiz. Okay, here it will simply embed it at first child element of the body element. We're working on that you get an on-the-fly window that you can drag and drop and resize, and then you can bring your apps movable in any website you want. So here, let's take again Wikipedia. Here I have a Kanban card. Here I can, you know it from the video. And now I can try the same here. I go, I make it shorter. Another website, don't know, web.de. And I get the same component. And now I can, from web.de to Wikipedia if I want. So that gives a lot of possibilities you can think about. Okay, back to the slides. Yeah. Okay, enough. So my main concern for this talk is to show you the possibilities and opportunities of the modular web. And I think that's done now. Yeah. You see many things, what's possible with a modular web. So how many time I have left? Okay. Okay, in view of time, we now come to the concrete technology for which I now hopefully motivated you enough. Since a detailed introduction to the technology would blow up the time by far, I will give you the most important basic data and show you where to find the source code and further information. So, my technology is a client-side component model, shortly CCM. If you have questions, then try. So the client-side component model is a model for running web components inside the browser and it consists of a CCM framework and CCM components. CCM uses two features of the worldwide web consortium web component standard, custom elements and Shadow Dome. The CCM framework provides two main services, one for embedding CCM components inside any web-based content and the other service for data management. Yep. Okay. The framework is a tiny JavaScript file with about 37 kilobytes minified or 10 kilobytes if it's zipped. And uses standard JavaScript only, so ECMAScript 5 only. And has no dependencies to other resources or frameworks. Yeah, before a year, I used jQuery in the framework because jQuery was like the air to breathe, but I kicked it out. It's the browsers are up to date today, so have so many improved that no one needs jQuery to. Not for the kind of browser compatibility. The browsers are compatibility enough. Yeah, if you can use the newest browser version. I talk only about that. Yeah.
As a professional web developer, you have customers who insist on using Internet Explorer 8 or something like that.
Yeah, I know these things, but this kind of web technologies, it's not possible. Also, with polyfills, you can reach a lot of things. But I think only of the newest versions of the browser. But mostly there are polyfills for just everything. Including web components. Yeah. But some polyfills not quite good. Example for Shadow Dome. Shadow Dome, polyfill. in Firefox, you will be angry. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, the CCM framework is published as free software under MIT license. Yeah, there you have the GitHub link. It is loaded automatically when a component is used. And this is the reason why you don't see the CCM framework in the HTML examples. Normally you have a script tag and then the framework comes in the web page. You don't have that. You only use the components and the framework will be loaded in the background. Yeah, like the Lego way, CCM components are recombinable. So this results in a dependency tree. Yeah, these dependencies are automatically solved recursively and asynchronously by the CCM framework at runtime. The framework makes sure that all dependent resources are loaded in parallel and no resource is loaded twice. Any dependent resource and data can be loaded cross-domain. The CCM framework and all CCM components are versioned and use semantic versioning, so the common 2.0.0 writing. The same component can be, that ensures backward compatibility. That's very important. The last month I only worked on that. A don't can start with community, for example, when it's not backward compatible. It don't makes any sense, but now I have it. Okay. The same CCM component can be embedded multiple times in the same web page and also different versions of the component of a component without any conflicts and side effects. That is because each component and version has its own namespace inside a web page. It is also possible to use different versions of the CCM framework in the same web page. Yeah, so I definitely have backward compatibility now. Yeah, here you see the main interfaces of the CCM framework. Since the last year, they have not many changed, but inside they have changed a lot. Before here, I don't use custom elements. I don't have Shadow DOM. I only have JavaScript. Embedding was only in JavaScript. And this year, I have used this HTML element web standards. So each web component I use, when I use a script tag of a CCM component, I automatically have the CCM custom element for this component. Yeah, the first interface, CCM load, is for loading resources. There you have much possibilities. You can control how it's serial loaded or parallel loaded. And all can be loaded cross-domain, including data. As that works with JSONP and cores and such things, for example. CCM.component is an interface for registration, a CCM component in a web page. Yeah. In this interface, there's a functionality that creates the custom element, for example. Then we have system CCM instance. That's for creation a CCM instance out of a component. That's for multiple embedding. If I don't have CCM instances and only the component, I could only embed a component only one time in a web page. That will be very bad. Yeah, for example, a rating component, I have 10 comments. I want for every comment a rating. I need it often. Okay. So here we have a little bit, but only a little bit, object orientation, so we can create instances out of a component. Yeah, then we have the start method that starts the CCM instance. That's normally this what embeds the component. So if you hit the CCM start method, they are all, the two above are implicit included. Yeah? When you hit start, the component will be loaded with CCM load, will be registered in the web page. It will be created an instance out of the component and hits the start method from this instance. And then you have your website area content. Yeah, then CCM store is counting on data management. With CCM store, you get back a CCM data store, which comes in the next slides, how this exactly works. Ah, okay, CCM helper also exists. There are many useful helper functions for component developers. Yeah, it's a good thing to have a look inside. It solves many problems that will be harder when you do it on your own. So here you see the levels of embedding of a CCM component. Sure, I can move. I hope you can see it. Not good font. Okay, here you have the URL of the component. Here's the configuration. And the configuration is only set, is only the website area of the component be set, but it can, it's dependent on the component you have. You can make such much more configuration things. But at the minimum, the website area must be defined. So, and here we have a callback. So we have CCM component. There we can give the URL of the component, and then the component will be loaded and registered in the web page. And then you get back the JSON object representation of the component. And from this object, you can control of yourself how many instances you want to create out of it. So here you can give the config, and you get one instance back and can hit the start method manually. So here's a level higher, a shortcut. CCM instance, you give the URL, and this way implicit calls this, registers the component in the web page, and you get an instance directly and can hit, that must be called start, not render. Before here it was called render, now it's start. Okay, and then finally you have the start method. Normally this is the only method you must know, because this directly gives you embeds the component. But if you have a component which reuses another component, you might be want to have more control about it, how you create instances out of it and how you embed them. Okay. Yeah, here, what's the code of a CCM component? Yeah, here you have some links for a few examples. Here's an example of the blank template. Class. You can build instances out of the component. Here is a classical start method. Yeah, and the classical hello world. Yeah. With this point element, you have access to your website area, and you can set the content of it. And here you can do anything you normally do with other frameworks or some whatever you want. You have the full power of the web and web technologies. Yeah, CCM only this technology only helps you to getting all here, and it's capsuled in one HTML element. This is primarily all CCM do for you. So you can embed it in any web-based content with one HTML tag. Okay, I go back here. So here I have only a few minutes. So here's another example where you can see how to reuse two components in another component. And the third example is a component where you have the pass is wrong. Okay, I correct the passes later. when you have a component that reuses a component, but you don't know how often you want to reuse the component. For example, you have comments, and you don't know how many comments you have, but you want a rating for every comment. So you don't know the number, how many rating instances you need. Then, if you have such a situation, then this example is the correct thing for you. Yeah, and you can see all my developed component, many examples. They also in the web component cloud. And here you can look into the source code. It's all MIT licensed, all free software. You can take it and do whatever you want with it, improve it, or whatever. Yeah. Then we have data management. Oh, I have text here. Okay, the CCM framework provides a service from component developers for data management. It allows the usage of CCM data stores. A CCM data stores can manage data sets in one of three data levels and can also be used autonomously of CCM components for easy data management. The different data levels are described below. CCM data stores are intended to be universal and provide a simple uniform API for basic create, read, update, delete operations. On the first level, the data will be managed in a local object. Then all managed data sets are fugitive data which are gone when leaving the website. On the second level, the data will be managed in a client-side database. Then all managed data is still there after page reload. This is especially interesting for offline functionality. On the third level for data, the data will be managed in a server-side database of choice. This is a classical way. The server must have a CCM compatible interface. Then all managed data sets are stored persistently on the server and they are not bound to a specific client. Different network protocols are possible for communication between client and server. In case of real-time communication with a WebSocket protocol for a CCM data store with data level 3, the server informs every active client about changing data sets. Then a CCM component which uses such a data store can react according to these changes, mostly by updating the front end immediately. Okay, here we have a code example where you see how to, if you have a CCM data store, how you can use this. You have a simply get set del interfaces. Yeah. Here for setting in data sets, for getting, and here for updating. And deletion. And here upstairs, here at the top, you see how you can get a CCM data store if you want to have one. Here you see how you can choose which data level, on which data level you want that the data sets are be managed. So you can give no parameter, no settings, then you have data level 1. Fugitive data, it's gone on page reload. But you can, perhaps you can give initial data to the data store. Yeah, then you can have here the URL of a JSON file versus the initial data is inside. If you want to have data level 2, yeah, then you simply give the name of the data store. And here on data level 3, also must put in the URL of the server interface, which is compatible to CCM. So, yeah, for the end, I know there are others out there. And I know I'm not a good speaker here, but the thing, what I have there, when you look close at it, and when you look close about other things, like what Google do, I have a very other view of web components as Google. For example. And I don't think it's an against. It's more an interesting thing. What are my advantages? What are their advantages? And how they can work together? So, that's it. Thanks for listening. Okay, now we come to questions. Next time I do it in German. Okay, then. Yeah, my idea was I have a YouTube video and then it goes more away, but I'm not good enough in English. I must read and. I hope you get the message.
Please repeat the questions you can ask, so the stream
appears. Yeah, okay. So, first question. Genau, this starts with a web component cloud. You need places where you find the web components, and these places, it can be many places, must have a quality sign or something for the components. And you must trust in this web component cloud or marketplace or something. Then you can get it there and download it and put it on your server of your choice or take it directly from there. What do you mean with security?
So I download it from the server, but I don't know if anybody had into the server and changed something about the component. So there's no signature or anything.
Yeah, I know this technology with the hash values. This is a good thing, By the web component clouds, the components are at the web components cloud. There is only the link, and the web component is on some server in the world. And this one that put it on that server and published it in this web component can make sure of that. So everyone is free. Everyone is free to do that. There are no restrictions from CCM to prevent it. Yes. That's also the same question, is it?
Yeah,
The server who holds the JavaScript file must care about this. That it's done. That's not in my reach. I'm a client-side component model, and the server. But I can think about it. That I have a mechanism that supports it better or easily. Yeah.
Actually, that would be possible. It's called sub-resource integrity, and it's a hash that you assign to the script tag that your component would embed for browser to load it. So in that case, you'd have to calculate the hash once, and the component would know, I want that component, but only if I have hash matches, and the browser checks it. So the check is done client-side, and you get some kind of integrity, and you know that nothing has been tampered with.
Okay.
So that was also my thought. Would be great if something like that would be in there sometime soon.
Yeah.
Because that would really make it much more secure.
Okay, good thing. You notice I don't make my focus on that before. Okay, another questions? Yeah.
Would you mind telling me something about performance? If you use it in a high complex or a way,
Okay, the question is, what's about performance? Is there anything done for performance? Yeah, we have tested, as a, with a professor, I have tested an course app as component, and there we optimized it for performance. So we have, for example, a menu component we used in this app, and we preloading everything we want. So before a click happens, everything that could be needed for a click is loaded already. We have at start a login button, and in the time the user goes to the login button and want to click, everything is loaded in the background, and steps of it. And so you click, and then our later steps will also be searched for anything that could be needed. And but this comes not for free. Also, if you take care about it, you can get much performance. Yes. There are tricks like you must watch that your first call of the website is only under a specific kilobytes. Then it's directly there. So there are some tricks in the internet. And yeah, but that's possible. It was really fast. The students in the learning units, and it was very cool. We must do it again. Yeah. Question?
Yeah. Sometimes we want to serve content statically for various reasons, including search engine optimizations. So have you tried to use components server from a server already?
You mean? I think I don't.
So these components are loaded dynamically in JavaScript. Have you tried to set them up so they can be loaded statically, like the whole assembly, and not from the client side, from the server side?
I don't get the question right. Do you have? Okay. We have tried this, yeah. Okay. Other questions? Yeah, behind. Again. I'm not good in English, or it's too. Yes, it's. So in the configuration of a component, there are some config values that must always be there. But the rest is completely customizable. Everything is set in the config, then it's up for you as a component developer to use it. So it gives conventions, some properties, but the website area, for example, but also the website area mustn't be set. This is the reason why it don't call render, it now calls start, because not every component must have a website area. Also, it gives nearly no restrictions. Also, they don't need it. Not at this pace, yeah. There are some upcoming conventions for user authentication. The user component is always at the property user. Then other things can know that and automatically, and then go something better directly. but it gives some points, but I don't remember all of them. No questions? Okay.
Yes. Thank you. Stay close to your question.